Good evening. I'm David Ryzik, and I'm pleased to be coming to you from the Honor Health Medical Center in Scottsdale, Arizona. The COVID-19 pandemic has touched our entire nation. Several months ago, we aired a segment chronicling the experience of physicians on the front line of the COVID-19 battle. Now, since that time, some things have changed. So-called hotspots like New York, Boston, and Detroit have experienced a dramatic reduction in cases being admitted to hospitals in those regions. At the same time, some new concerns have arisen, such as Scottsdale, Arizona, now arguably considered the nation's hotspot, where there is a growing seroprevalence of disease in the community, and hospitals are being pushed to the brink of resource depletion. I have had the rare privilege of visiting with nurses from some of the hardest hit areas, in some cases witnessing firsthand the heroism of America's nurses. Tonight, I am joined by nurses from across the nation who have been on the front lines of this battle. Their stories extraordinary. Their lives changed professionally and personally in a sudden and dramatic fashion as they continue to wage a war against an enemy invisible, unpredictable, and not easily defeated. I am joined from Royal Oak, Michigan, Jessica Wills, Marina Ventimiglia, Katie Lisfeld, Diane Capocha. From our hometown, Scottsdale, Arizona, Olivia Sitton, Alexa DeSable, and Michelle Fiore. From Boston, Rena Smith. And from New York, Michelle Lindquist. I thank each of you for joining me tonight. Your stories and experiences are extraordinary, and I'm excited to hear them. Michelle Fiore, I'll start with you. You and I have known each other for nearly 30 years. We were together the morning of 9/11. We lived through the AIDS epidemic of the 1990s. From a medical and nursing standpoint, is this the biggest world event that you can remember?
You know, Dr. Ryzik, I thought that the AIDS epidemic was something that I would never forget, but actually the COVID pandemic is much worse and affecting more people. In the early 80s, we treated these patients as if they were contaminated. We wouldn't even touch them. We wore moon suits in the ICU and so forth. Families couldn't visit. They had to look through their loved ones through glass windows of the ICU. But it was more segregated to certain people, certain demographic. This pandemic has no boundaries. This pandemic is hitting everyone, including our own staff. There's no one person, there's no one sexuality, gender that we can say that this is only, COVID only applies to. It's everyone, and that's the scary part of it all. We don't know who is walking around, who is contaminating other people. We really don't know how it's spreading. We only have speculation to that. But I would have to say in all my 40 years of doing nursing, I'd have to say that this is the worst thing that I've ever seen.
Wow, that's so interesting. Jessica, you and I talked about sort of our initial experiences. My initial experience was with a patient who had just undergone TAVR. And it was exactly what Michelle said. It was the fear of the unknown. My first thought was, okay, I'm taking care of a TAVR patient who has COVID-19. I'm just going to resign myself to contracting coronavirus. And somehow, the concern about getting this patient through a valve operation paled in comparison to wondering if he was going to survive COVID-19. How did you navigate those initial fears? Simply going to work, knowing that you were going to be surrounded by this at Beaumont Hospital for a 12-hour shift multiple days per week.
At first, it was very, very intimidating, scary. We were all, you know, we didn't know how it was passed on from person to person. You didn't know what to expect. When they had made us officially like a COVID-only unit, that one day we got like 8 admits all at once, and like rolling in, you're like, oh my gosh, all these people are probably going to die. But I would say you just kept going in. You wore your PPE. You watched each other's backs. You helped each other out. We had great teamwork, so that helped. And then after, I would say, about 2 weeks, your body kind of just became numb to it. Like, you just were like, okay.
You had to create, you said to me that you had to create, as emotional as this was, you had to create that distance between you and the patient. You were with them at all times, but you had to create some sort of emotional distance just to get through the shift.
Right. You had to become numb, kind of. And that sounds really bad, but for you to get through it, you had to be kind of like separate your emotions from it and just go in and do the meds and turn them and do the best you can, but still protect yourself.
Marina, I got to know you very well as you and Jessica cared for my mother, who was admitted to Beaumont Hospital during the latter part of the pandemic crisis there. You contracted coronavirus and you were out of work for nearly a month. That must have been frightening.
It was very frightening. I worked for a few shifts when it all started, and I felt very weak afterwards. I thought it was just the stress and the anxiety of it all, until I took my temperature and I had a fever. I was quarantined in my room for 28 days, and I was scared. I didn't know if I was going to end up as one of our patients. I felt guilty not being at work with my coworkers and helping them. It was awful. It was a long month.
You told me at one point that you were preparing your husband, for potentially the worst.
Yeah, I had, I remember 3 episodes where I really thought I was going to have to go to the hospital. There was a day where I called my sister and put her on speakerphone because I thought I was going to collapse, and she was going to have to come over and take care of my kids while he took care of me. It was a lot of dark moments that I experienced, a lot of anxiety.
How has this changed you as a nurse? More cautious? What changes, what evolution as a nurse has this produced?
I think it's changed everybody in the medical field. I think as medical professionals, we are pretty confident in what we do. And I think we are used to protocols that we follow in treatments. We know what medications to use for, you know, specific illnesses. But with COVID, it was the unknown. We didn't know how to treat it. We didn't know who had it, if the tests were accurate. So it definitely added a feeling of helplessness and anxiety. I think obviously hand washing and wearing your PPEs properly. And we have amazing teamwork on our unit, but it was even better throughout this COVID experience.
You said to me that you don't take anything for granted. Any patient who's infected, coughing, even if you know they have respiratory syncytial virus, you take nothing for granted in terms of protecting yourself and protecting your coworkers.
Yeah, I noticed when I came back to work, and some of the girls will probably laugh at this, but one of my main questions when I would get report from the EC, it would be, you know, were they tested? And if they came up and I still felt like they had every possible symptom and I was concerned, I would kind of push for a second test because, you know, we didn't know how accurate they were.
Yeah, I agree with you. This has changed the way I look at even the simple things. I tend not to take anything for granted. Diane, I watched you manage a unit firsthand. I thought it was incredible. As nurses start to contract COVID-19, as I think one night there were 30-some intubations at Beaumont Hospital, how does a manager maintain team morale?
That was super difficult. We're very fortunate that our teamwork prior to COVID, we truly are a family. And I think that is what got us through. I mean, we've always supported one another through, you know, every life event, every tragedy that everyone's gone through. So we have a different bond. I think you have to have a bond in order to have great teamwork, and that we're very fortunate to have that. The one thing that we did do is all about information sharing. So our CNO would do a 2 o'clock call. So we would bring all our concerns to a Skype call, and we would, you know, go through everything. Like, did we have enough PPE? Did we have isolation gowns? Did we, you know, what was, what are we seeing? What's going on with anesthesia? So then after that point, I would come back and share with the staff what the latest and greatest was, what was going on, if we were lacking any equipment, or if we were seeing, you know, other symptoms to be on the lookout for. There was a lot of, you know, really just one-on-one time with each nurse and how are you doing and what we can we do to support. It's all about presence. You can't be a missing in action manager. You have to be there. And that's what we did. I mean, you know, we worked 10, 12 hours just to be there to support the staff, because that's the only thing you could do. I mean, it's emotionally trying. They were upset and you just offered them comfort, but it's pure support. That's the only way to keep up morale, is you have to be there. You have to listen to them, ease their fears. And it's all about information.
You know, you made a great point about communication. Things, especially at the early stages when Detroit was the most affected, things were changing and evolving so rapidly. Our knowledge about what this disease was, how did you maintain good, crisp communication with this rapid influx of information?
You know, it's really...
Was it just the frequency of your communication with your staff?
I think for us, it was the 2 o'clock call, because if anything was changing in the next day, we would have that information. You would start in the morning and just, you know, you kind of were constantly watching. If someone was in a room for 3 or 4 hours, you know, then we start knocking on the windows and saying, all right, it's time to get out. So I had to be in tune with every single person there. Every person would have their break point, and they would, you know, they would lose a patient, and then they needed that time just to like just walk away. And then they were just getting, you know, then right after that, there was a new one coming. So you really had to pay attention to everyone's emotional state. Because it's post-traumatic stress. I mean, that to the highest hilt. I mean,
post-traumatic stress, and yet you have to go into your next shift. Unbelievable. Yeah. Katie, I think you're my hero. I think you are my new hero. Having listened to what you and your family went through, and yet you went sleeves rolled up back to work. Do you mind sharing the story of what you've had to do, what you've had to deal with personally and professionally during this pandemic?
So my story is probably pretty interesting. There is 8 members in my family, 6 children and 2 parents, my dad almost 92, my mom 88. We all live within a mile of my parents. There's 4 of us literally on the same street. And then I did have a sister down in Florida. She's the only one that didn't contract it, because she was down in Florida. So
all of them contracted it.
Everybody got it in varying different degrees. So thank God for my sister-in-law, because she made my brother, and she's more of the panic type, go get tested. Thank God he did, because then we knew what we were dealing with. So going forward, I had my younger sister and I, mild cases, my 2 brothers, fever, temperature, body aches, in bed. My 3rd brother, who is very interesting, has underlying issues. And there was a point where it was just myself and my husband taking care of him. And every time I went over there, is he getting enough fluids? Is he, you know, getting the things he needs? Because he was throwing up. He was nausea, vomiting, throwing up. I watched him aspirate. I literally had to roll him over onto his side because he was weak. I started calling his internist. This was on a Friday. I called his internist Saturday, keep him at home. Called his internist Sunday, keep him at home. He had a Zoom on Monday. And I had to make the decision, you know, thank God I'm an ICU nurse. I'm like, he's not peeing and he's not getting fluids. He needs to go in to the hospital. So I had to call 911 on my own brother. And this is 4 hours after my mom had passed away and knowing that my dad would pass the next day. And knowing how close my brother was to these two people, because he's single, has never been married and no children. So
this was the entire family got sick. Your mom and dad died about 24 hours apart. I guess your team mates, team members at work, in addition to your family, become extremely important to you.
Just the moral support and the, you know, hearing on what was going on there at the hospital and knowing my brother's there and can't, you know, go in and see him because I'm in my own quarantine because I have it. But, you know, calling and telling nurse, bring a TriFlow in there, make sure he's sitting up, you know, knowing, you know, just to reiterate, you know, I was the nurse who was the sister who, you know, had to be there for her brother because he didn't have anybody else.
I think this is an amazing story, and I really think it underscores what our nurses here in America do, the way they have to put their own personal crises secondary when they go back to work. They're going to take care of someone who's basically a total stranger and put their own family issues and whatnot aside. Alexa, when you and I talked, we were talking about these multi-generational households, and you commented that Katie's story is actually a common one where multiple members of a family and multiple generations contract this, and that was your experience.
So in Arizona, we see a lot of patients from the Navajo Nation. And so a lot of these patients live under the same household with multiple generations. And so we'll get a lot of patients where they have it, their brothers have it, their sisters, their moms, their dads. So it's very similar to her situation. And in the Navajo Nation, they don't have running water or they're not very well taken care of. So we had a patient that was living actually in his car for a couple weeks because he didn't want to spread the coronavirus to the rest of his family. So that obviously participated in his quick decline, but it's very interesting to see how they live.
And yours is a unique story because you are in the COVID ICU and your mother, a wonderful nurse, is on the medical floor, which has the most COVID patients in our system. Do you guys check on each other? Do you guys worry about each other? Do you just want to hear her voice or something during the day?
Yeah, so she's a typical mom. She texts me all the time, every day, asking me, making sure I'm washing my hands, washing my hair, putting my PPE on correctly. So we talk every day, and then at night we'll call each other after our shift. So it's helpful that we're both going through it, but at the same time, it kind of adds more stress and anxiety for the rest of our family because we're both exposed all day, every day. So.
Wow. I'm pleased to have Michelle from New York. She is at Presbyterian with several of my close physician friends. Michelle, it's nice to have you with us. You were amongst the first to have to pivot, converting cath labs, ORs into COVID units. Tell us about that.
It was quite crazy. It was, it happened very quickly when it first came out. They had us float to the other ICUs just to kind of get a handle on working in an ICU again. And the patients were coming up from the ER and within hours decompensating and needing to be intubated. And it just all happened so fast. Within a few days, they were converting all the ORs into ICUs and the cath lab into ICUs. And I felt like we really had the rug pulled out from under us. It was unbelievable how quick it went.
Yeah, I do believe that as I think about this, it's the rapidity with which our lives changed. And I know at Presbyterian, in speaking to several of the physicians and nurses there, your life changed as fast as any other hospital in the world because that's where really the first epicenter was. and converting these cath labs and ORs and these units into COVID units, and yet maintaining your personal protection, I know was a spectacular challenge. One of the things that you and I talked about in preparation for this is the fact that hospitals, pretty much all hospitals, have adopted policies that families can't come and visit. How difficult was that to essentially see patients very sick, in some cases dying, with no family support?
Horrible. Absolutely horrible. To just be all alone like that. And to be honest, you really didn't have the time to spend with them because we were so overwhelmed with the amount of patients that we all had. And it was very sad just to see people laying there without anybody, any family members. And I have to say that we all did a really good job in trying to contact the family every day. But it was a very sad situation.
What did you do personally as a nurse to try and, be that family for them?
Of course you would just try to talk to them, and we could get their family on an iPhone or an iPad and put it up to their ear, and hopefully they could hear what they were saying, and made a few calls to the family. But every day, your patient population changed so dramatically, even within the day, that it was really hard to maintain or to even build a relationship with even the families, because it was all changing so quickly.
Wow. Olivia, you and I had a very similar discussion about this, about how difficult it was to see patients essentially alone, no family members to support. But you also talked to me about how nurses adapted, about technology, about iPads. Talk about what we're doing in Scottsdale along these lines.
Yeah, it's been very difficult to see that. Families are really missing their loved ones. Their loved ones really need their families. So we've either been using, technology has been great because we've been using either patients' iPhones. If they're in the room, we can easily FaceTime their loved ones. Or now we have tablets that we can take into the room and set up a similar FaceTime situation, and they get to see each other and connect. And I think that's been very helpful, supporting both sides of it, the patient and the family. Even when the patients are sedated, I can tell that they still hear their family's voices, because when I've been trying to get their blood pressure up all day, this happened yesterday, couldn't get it up with the medications. I got their loved ones on the phone, and I think just hearing that voice, their blood pressure all of a sudden came up. So they are hearing and they're connecting in different ways. And I had another patient, before we had the tablet, I suggested to the wife that maybe she write a letter. And she wrote a beautifully well-written letter to her husband. And I read it every single day. I'm getting goosebumps. I read it every single day to this patient. And she talked about how she was waiting to cut the roses until he got home. And she was waiting to pick the oranges from the tree to make their morning orange juice before they went on their walk. And as much as it helped, I think, the patient connect, it helped the nurses. It helped me connect so much to the patient and remember that it's not just this paralyzed or sedated person that's intubated. He has this whole life, and it really gave us an insight to connect with this patient and really just give him all we had.
So that is just so fantastic. I've watched you do this, and that is just so fantastic. Rena, Boston was also one of those early epicenters. I had the sense that as things were revving up in New York, Mass General was really busy preparing. As adults, we watch police, firefighters, first responders risk their lives every day. It's part of what they do. Did you ever think that would be you putting your life potentially at risk, Rena, going to work each day?
It was so funny because you did hear it all on the media, but it was still us coming to the unit. We still had patients to care for. It was scary, but it was still this sense of, like, these people still need care. And while we were very scared of the unknown, you know, we didn't know that much about the virus. We were looking at New York very closely. We were hearing things in our local media saying, oh, we're maybe 2 weeks out from where New York is today, maybe 3 weeks out, 1 week out, 5 days. And you just kind of built this tension. And you just kind of, I don't know, a lot of us went into just kind of automatic mode where you just had to focus on taking care of your patients.
Wow. You know, as you and I talked in preparation for this, you in some ways said when you looked out on the street, it reminded me of the time immediately after the Marathon Boston bombings in 2013, when you were told to shelter in place. There was sort of an eerie look to Boston with no one on the streets.
That's right. I actually still live in the apartment that is a couple of streets over from where the Boston bomber lived with the family at the time. So we were under strict quarantine, under shelter in place. And just, it seemed so, like such a controlled period of time when I look back on it, to this extended period of time of seeing just vacant highways, vacant roads, nobody walking around. And yet, you know, the people you did see on my way, you know, if I'm going to work for my 7 a.m. shift, you knew that these people who were on the road with you were also going to do an essential job. And, you know, you just kind of felt like the only other time you had seen that for me was when we were in shelter in place and during the Boston bombing.
Right. Wow. Jess, we talked about that given the fact that these patients stayed in the hospital for many weeks, you developed some incredible, you as nurses developed some incredible bonds. You also said that as you adapted to technology and put FaceTime in the rooms or iPads in the room, you said, and I'm reading from our conversation, we became privy to intimate and emotionally charged conversations. Most times it was a family member pleading for the patient to get better because there was an upcoming wedding, anniversary, a lifetime goal, an upcoming event, or simply the words, I cannot live without you. I'm guessing you were listening to some of this, knowing that these patients, many of them were not going to make it.
Yeah, that was really challenging. So we would try to do the group care where you bring in all your meds and turn all at the same time. So you'd call them and you'd put the phone down, or, you know, you'd help set up the iPad, and you would just hear the pain and everything in their voice of them just wanting their loved one to come through and pull through. And in your head, you're just like, oh, you know, the patient's not going home. They're just way too sick. I mean, they're at the end of their fight. And just to hear their loved one pleading so hard and just, please, I cannot live without you. And knowing they haven't seen each other for weeks. And, you know, it's just such a big disconnect. Like, they had to trust the nurses to be like, yeah, he can't breathe. Yeah, he's not doing well. You know, it was so hard to paint the picture when they can't come in and see him on the ventilator, on the CRRT. So it was just very, very, I mean, you're all in your full PPE and you're fighting back tears the whole time because it's just so sad.
This question, I just thought of this question, and this is for the Detroit, the Royal Oak Beaumont nurses. I understand why New York developed into a hotspot early. I understand why Boston did. These areas are pretty compact. People are, it's almost like sardines in some parts of New York. Can any of you tell me why did Detroit develop into such an early hotspot? What was it? I'm curious from the Detroit nurses, what their impression was, why it happened so quickly there.
I think one of the things is that I know that we do have direct flights to and from New York. And then I think too, around Oakland County, there's a lot of international business travel. So, I mean, you're getting more of the international travelers coming in and out. A lot of people use Detroit as a hub when they come from New York to go to different areas of the country. And I just think that it was just how it traveled. But I think it had a lot to do with the international traveling and the New York to Detroit stuff.
Diane, Marina, Katie, any other thoughts on why this hit so? I think it was unexpected. I think it took everybody by surprise that Detroit hit so early.
I don't think, I mean, you know, there's a lot of theories. We, you know, Detroit has a lot of underserved population and access to care, and did they stay home too long? And again, you have a group of, my daughter, who share homes. And so again, it was that whole family that would get sick. And so I think we did see a lot of that, whole families, brothers, sisters who passed. So that is our big thing. My niece is a resident at Henry Ford, and we would talk all the time, like, what is it? Like, what's our trigger points? And that's basically what we come up with, is it spread very rapidly.
It's my understanding that people that came to Beaumont Hospital came from long distances. In other words, Beaumont Hospital is on 13 Mile, and there were patients coming from quite a bit of a distance away from there, from the inner city. Is that correct?
I can't answer that because, in all honesty, I haven't been back. So I wasn't there during that. So you'd have to, Marina, Diane, or Jessica would be your go-to.
I do think that that's true, but that's our typical population. So we do get a lot of people that migrate to Beaumont. It's, you know, Henry Ford, again, when you start seeing other area hospitals that are full, those patients are going to go to the next hospital. And I think that's kind of what they were seeing, is that Henry Ford was getting full. So, you know what, I'm going to go to Beaumont. Maybe, you know, Beaumont has better resources. And I think that's a lot of what we still see, is that they're trying to go to that hospital that has, quote unquote, better resources.
Michelle from New York and Rena from Boston, what were some of the racial, ethnic, socioeconomic, or gender disparities that you guys saw in your hospitals?
For us in Boston, we definitely saw young male Hispanic, like a much larger population concentrated there. We had many rooms that were just filled with 40-something-year-olds, and that it was very, you know, I think it was surprising to certain coworkers, but it, you know, in some cases, when you thought about later on how the virus works and everything, and when you ask these patients what they do for a living, how do they live, who lives with them, it kind of became clear why this population was getting affected. But initially, we definitely saw a disparity in the majority of the patients that we were seeing.
What about in New York?
Yeah, I would say the same. New York Presbyterian is located in Washington Heights, which is mainly an immigrant population. Lots of multi-generational families all living together. And I have to say that most of our patients were from that background. You know, on the younger side, I would say more male than female. But yeah, I think it was people, you know, with the crowded living situations that we saw mainly.
What are we seeing here in Scottsdale, Arizona, Olivia and Alexa?
You know, social determinants of health has played a huge role, I think, with this virus. And some of us are very lucky. We have good access to healthcare. We've been brought up in environments that really support good hygiene, diet, exercise, things like that. And then we're seeing a lot of people on the, Alexa mentioned this before, but the Native American population and Hispanic population. And they don't have the same support system. They don't have the same access to healthcare. And it's showing. And I think now, while we have everyone's attention, I mean, everyone has been affected in some way by this, by someone they know, or a lot of people, a loved one. maybe in their family's been affected. And I think as a healthcare group, now's the time where this is our time to strike and create an awareness about this topic in particular and come together that in a way that we can affect across all economic structures, how to educate and get people involved and aware of their own health to hopefully prevent something like this happening again.
You know, Alexa, our Native American population that we're seeing, they have an incredibly high rate of obesity, hypertension, and diabetes. It seems to me, Alexa, that that clearly is an adverse prognostic indicator in these patients.
Yeah, I would agree. We do tend to see a lot of males, like New York and Boston we're talking about, and then they will be between like 40s or 30 years of age, and they'll say they won't have any health problems, but then we'll do an A1C and it's greater than 9, you know? So,
undiagnosed healthcare problems.
Right. So I think that and the obesity is definitely participating in this virus for sure.
Got it. Michelle, you and I have talked, the STEMI volume, Michelle Fiore, the STEMI volume has, it just seems to have dropped off dramatically. What's going on? What's your perception of that?
Well, I would agree. We have seen less STEMIs, but not just in Arizona. Nationally, they're down 30 to 50%. Patients are afraid. They're afraid to come to the hospital. They're afraid that they're going to contract COVID. So unfortunately, by the time they do get to us, their care has been delayed. So then, of course, they get complications afterwards because of the delay in the care of their heart attacks.
That's so interesting. The last I heard, we've had 3 patients with VSDs related to a STEMI. I see one of those every 5 or 6 years, but I think that reinforces this delay in care because we know that a post-STEMI VSD is a result of delay in care. I have not seen one in several years, and we've already seen 3 in a very short period of time. So I think that's an excellent point. Let me ask you guys the question. I'm going to throw this open to all of the nurses. So tell me what works from a nursing standpoint. Proning. We talk about recruitment, alveolar recruitment. Does proning work? Is it your experience that proning works in these patients? I'm throwing this out to anyone. Don't be shy, ladies.
I'll answer. Yes, it does work. We've manually prone so many of our patients now, not even looking at the rotoprone bed, but just with the manual proning and being diligent with that, we have seen the recruitment. We've seen the hypoxia change and turn around for us for a lot of our patients. So actually in the COVID patients, it does work.
So Alexa and Olivia, I came in because I wanted to see, you know, I've heard about proning, but I didn't know how you guys do it. Wow, this is labor intensive. I came in one day, you guys took me through it. I put my gloves on and worked with you guys. It's not pushing a button, right?
No, it's a lot of work. It takes at least 5 people. If you have someone, I would say under 200 pounds, and about half of our COVID population, I would say is even more than that. So you might need more than 5 people, maybe up to 7 people in the room with you at a time, a whole team. And essentially we wrap them up like a burrito, put a sheet on top, wrap them up, and then we flip them. One person has to be at the head with the intubation tube, and then the rest of us all have to be in sync, and you go over, up, and then over again. And it's a lot of work.
But Alexa, you were saying that we really do see benefits of this in our patients.
Yes, I agree. Most of our patients, almost all of them, we prone, and they seem to be getting a little better, especially with the proning. So yeah, I think it's definitely working.
Michelle from New York, blood thinners. Sahil Parikh, one of your physicians in New York, had a protocol. I think he was the first to have a formal protocol on blood thinners. How essential are blood thinners?
Most of the patients I took care of, they were using blood thinners on them, but because we were from the cath lab, we didn't our staff didn't really have a home base in the ICUs. So like a lot of the nurses are saying on the call, they kind of were able to develop that relationship or going back to the same place every day. Whereas for us, we were mainly used as floaters kind of. So every day you were in a different spot. But I did see that a lot of patients were on blood thinners.
How about in Boston? Rena?
We were definitely, it was part of the cocktail of medications that the COVID patients were being given. You know, where applicable, they were getting Lovenox shots. They tried to minimize use of heparin because of the pumps. And then having staff, you know, going in to adjust pumps. But we did notice that people coming in were being given Lovenox.
And what about our nurses in Detroit? What about your experience? Were you guys anticoagulating these people across the board? Jessica?
Yeah, pretty much everyone was starting. We were doing the IV heparin. So yeah, everyone was always anticoag just because of like the blood clots, the PEs, the, you know, just everything that goes on with COVID.
Anybody have experience with hydroxychloroquine? What's your experience with hydroxychloroquine or your observations about hydroxychloroquine?
I, at one point, I think that everyone was on it.
Yes, I agree.
That and vitamin C and zinc, and then week by week it would change. But and then at our hospital, it actually became a controlled substance. So you had to count it and verify it just like you would any narcotic. So,
Katie, did you, were you put on hydroxychloroquine?
No, but my brother was. And he was in the hospital for 14 days, and my brother picked him up, and the first words out of his mouth was that it saved his life.
Marina, did you go on hydroxychloroquine when you first got sick?
I did. I took it for about 2 days, and I started having blurred vision with it. Really bad. It was very obvious. And I called the my primary doctor, and, you know, it said these vision side effects could happen after taking them for a long time. But I was sure it was causing it. I actually texted our pharmacist for our unit, and she agreed with it. She just felt like maybe that was causing it. And after stopping it, my vision improved.
Oh,
so I only took it for about 48 hours.
Okay, that's great. The data on remdesivir is promising. In terms of hydroxychloroquine, we're starting a protocol in conjunction with Beaumont and Henry Ford, the WIP COVID protocol. You know, these are trials that are used as prophylactic agents for healthcare workers that are exposed. We don't know that it works once you have the disease, but Henry Ford, Beaumont, and Honor Health in Scottsdale will be participating in the hydroxychloroquine trial for prevention of COVID-19 in healthcare workers. What about Decadron? Is that a drug that that you guys use on any kind of regular basis?
We have a new COVID patient this week, and they did start him on PO Decadron.
Yeah, PO or IV Decadron. What about New York and Boston? Any experience with Decadron there?
I would say sporadic. Okay. It wasn't a consistent medication that we gave all the time.
I would agree.
Yeah, it's intended to mitigate the cytokine storm. Let me ask you this. Throw this open to all of the nurses. I don't know if you saw in today's New England Journal the mRNA 1273 vaccine. The early results are promising. It seemed to induce a favorable immune response in all of the participants, and there wasn't a single trial-limiting safety concern identified. As nurses on the front line, and this is going to come back, we're not done with COVID-19 in any part of this country. How important to you as nurses is the vaccine?
I think if we don't develop a vaccine, our life as we know it will never get back to normal.
That's interesting. Jessica?
I agree with Diane. I think we definitely need a vaccine. I think though a lot of people are going to be afraid to be some of the first ones to receive it because, you know, vaccines normally aren't developed as quickly and as rapidly. So it's like, are steps being missed? Is it really that safe? What about the long-term effects? But then at the same time, it also, it's most likely that the healthcare workers are going to be required to get it just like a flu shot. So that's also a little concerning that, you know, it's going to be approved and then they're going to be like, okay, all ICU nurses have to get it, just like the flu shot.
Rena, how important is a vaccine to you?
If it makes this go away or minimize the amount of COVID patients and people that are exposed to it, it would be great. I think that we need more research and we need more treatments. We need answers to how to fight COVID. I agree with Jessica. I don't think I would be the first in line to get this vaccine because I feel like it's probably been rushed. But in the future, I think it would put everybody at ease a little bit and we can maybe have more of a normal life again.
Rena, what about you? How do you feel about a vaccine?
So I agree with the other ladies that absolutely we need a vaccine. And I think their concerns are actually concerns that are echoed by just the community at large, where people want a vaccine, but they are also keenly aware that this is a fast-tracked process, that it's unusual, and that sometimes long-term effects aren't known. And sometimes people, you know, are we going to be able to convince them to get it? And then, you know, our patient populations, I mean, I can already see where patients ask us as nurses, you know, would you get it? And, you know, what do you say to that? Because you're just human, just like they are. And, you know, you have the same fears. So yes, absolutely. We need a vaccine. How we're going to get there and how we're going to convince people to trust it and get it is, I think, yet to be seen.
Okay. Alexa and Olivia, vaccine important to you?
Yeah, I agree with everyone else. Especially in Arizona, we kind of had mild cases at the beginning, and now we're just a huge hotspot. So I think if life is ever going to go back to normal, we need a vaccine. It's just the compliance with it is going to be a big issue.
Olivia?
I think everyone else has spoken to that exactly how I feel.
Okay.
It's going to be important, especially to reopen our economy and everything, but there is a little pause before taking it. Mm-hmm.
You know, I think the nursing profession is an amazing profession. I don't know that you guys know this. My mother was a pediatric ICU nurse, and my sister was an MICU nurse. Many of you are married. You have spouses, children, parents. How is it that you continue every day to commit yourself to leaving your families to essentially go care for people who are strangers to you? How is it that you guys get the will to do that?
I can say that in my family, my husband is also a first responder. He's a battalion chief in the fire department. And I think that, I think it's something that you're born to do. I think you have to have it in your bones, kind of, that, you know, you just get up every day and you go and you just, like other nurses had said on this, push everything aside and just keep going. And I don't think it's for everyone, but I think when you love what you do and you have a passion for it, you just keep going. And I don't know.
I think, as you said, it's born in you. It's a calling, and either you have it or you don't. I have a daughter who just finished nursing school and just passed the NCLEX this weekend. Thank you very much. And encouraging, you know, she's not worried. She's just, this is what she's always wanted. Her path was a little curved, not straight and narrow, but this is what you are called to do.
Michelle Fiore.
I totally agree. And it's innate. It's just something that you want to do. You put other people before you, before your own family. I mean, we do it with our holidays, everything. I have a daughter also who's a nurse. She's an oncology nurse, and then she works with bone marrow transplant patients. So she's at the same risk that we all are at, even more. She's so concerned about her patients and her not contracting COVID so she doesn't pass it on. But it's just something that, you do, and you, like you said, you love what you do. It is a passion. The one thing that if we look at COVID globally, it has done something really truly wonderful for the nursing profession. It has elevated our profession, that the image of the nurse has totally changed of what we do and what we sacrifice all the time. And whoever thought of the theme, 2020 was the year of the nurse, is actually, we are living the year of the nurse.
So I want to get into our parting shots. I'm going to give each one of you a chance to answer a question. And I'm going to start off with our two nurse managers, Diane and Michelle Fiore. And it dovetails nicely. What, Diane and Michelle, what effect will this year, this spring and summer, what effect will this have on young people, young women and men deciding to go into a career in nursing?
Well, I hope it has a positive effect. If you truly, if, as we say, if it's innate, then you want to go and you want to help. I hope it doesn't have a negative effect where people are so fearful that we lose our future nurses at the bedside. So that is a concern. But I think with all of us, if we speak out and do things like this and just put it out there to the public of what we do and why we do it, and look at all of us, thank God we're safe. Look, you've gone through COVID, you and your family's gone through COVID. You're here now to talk about it. I think the message has to get out to everyone, and hopefully that people will continue to want to be a part of our profession.
Diane, what are your thoughts on this?
I think for me, the jury's still out. We've just seen a steady decline in enrollment in nursing. It's sad to say that. We're hoping that, you know, once everyone gets past fear, that they'll come back to the calling. You're going to have that group of people that it is their calling. And this is why we were put here. You know, we sacrifice so many things, but if it's your calling, you'll come back. And if it was like, oh, well, it's a great job, then they just won't come back because their fear. There's still too much fear, the fear of bringing it home to their family, especially the young moms and stuff. It's still very real.
We're still living it. Oh, I agree. Jessica, how, as you look back years from now, what will you remember about the spring of 2020?
Well, I mean, obviously COVID, but I think it's just, I mean, I will always, I mean, the group of coworkers that I had and how we all came together and fought COVID as a team, and how even like physicians even started to treat us different. Like they weren't going in the rooms. They would like send us in and be like, so what was your assessment? Because they wanted to preserve PPE. So like they trust us more, you know, like they valued us and trust us more. And the cardiologists, they were even just walking around being like, what can we do to help? You know, like, cause they, obviously we weren't having the cath lab patients and everything. So they're like, what can we do to help? So it just, I mean, it just, I would say it was just brought us all together, and that we just were just an amazing team that fought a horrible, horrible virus.
Very good. Marina, Marina, I have a question for you. How does Detroit get back, my beloved Detroit where I'm from, how does it get back to a feeling of normalcy? How does Detroit step back into life again?
$1 million question. I think it's just going to take time. I think it's going to take, you know, more research and finding out what treatments work and hopefully a vaccine. I think in the meantime, we need to just get used to where we're at right now and work as a community and wear our masks and wash our hands and do our best to stop spreading it. Try to live like we used to. I mean, still, you know, go outside and visit family members, but with caution and just being more careful. I think it's just going to take a long time.
Rena, we talk about Boston strong. Is Boston returning to normal?
You know, it's funny you said that. I actually went out and had lunch with two of my coworkers for the first time in months. And it was a little nerve-wracking, but at the same time, it was good to see other people out, and it was good to see that they were taking it very seriously. We went to an area by the seacoast, which would normally this time of year be packed, and we found parking within minutes. But it was great, and it was also very interesting, just as we in the medical profession innovated with technology, that you know, the restaurant industry is innovating. They had us scan our phones with like a QR code to get the menus on our phone so that they didn't have to give us anything physically. Being nurses, we did bring our own Clorox wipes and we wiped the table down even though they were sanitizing. So, I mean, I think there's, you know, definitely glimmers of normalcy returning, but I think it just has to be paced out and each phase has to be observed. And if we need to roll it back, I think we should. But I think it's headed in the right direction.
Boy, I have a wife and four daughters, and the Clorox wipe story sounds very, very familiar.
Oh, you Clorox everything, Lysol everything.
Milk cartons, yeah, I know. Michelle Lindquist, New York is such a special case because of everything that occurred there. Can you ever imagine doing anything more important or more relevant in your professional career?
No. I thought for New York, I thought after 9/11, I thought kind of that was the worst of it. And I just feel everyone in New York is, you know, very PTSD'd from everything that's happened. And I think COVID really took us in complete shock to see our city streets empty like that. And it was just devastating. And I don't know, I find that at least a lot of us in the hospital, a lot of my coworkers, we're treading cautiously, you know, we're very cautious and, you know, afraid that it will come back.
Yep. Olivia and Alexa. So right now we in Scottsdale are in the epicenter of the storm. Just listening to the stories of your nursing colleagues from around the nation, is this reassuring that eventually there's somewhat of a light at the end of the tunnel? Olivia, I'll start with you.
It does, especially Rena's story with going out to lunch and hearing, I never thought about the QR code as a, pulling that up as a menu, like what a great idea. So yeah, it does give me hope moving forward and hearing about this vaccine that came out today that you're talking about. There is hope, and it's also amazing how much innovative ideas have come out of this disease. I mean, it's been horrible, but sometimes you just have to look on the bright side, and that's one of them.
Alexa?
Yeah, I agree with Olivia. I think hearing stories from Boston and New York and Detroit, they were all hit pretty hard early on, so now that's kind of what we're experiencing here in Arizona. So knowing that they got through it and that it's getting a little better for them gives us nurses here a little bit of hope.
All right, Katie, you get the final word. Decades from now, your 15-year-old grandson sits next to you and says, Grandma Katie, in U.S. history today, we studied the pandemic of 2020. What will you tell him about that?
Well, I lived through it. As you know, your great grandparents died of it and our whole family was hit. But I want you to know family is so important. Family at work, family with your neighbors, family within your own family. Life is good and you will get through it because everybody got through it in 2020 and there's still hope.
Very good. Well, ladies, thank you for joining us this evening. You have heard from, in my mind, real American heroes, nurses who put their love and commitment to patient care above all other considerations. Our prayers remain with all our colleagues on the front lines of this battle around the country. And from all of us at SIF Virtual, please, please stay safe. Thank you for joining us.